Just to say a warm welcome to tonight's lecture by Dr. Louise Fenton. And the lecture tonight is The Legend of Annie Palmer and Rose Hall. So really excited for this lecture, really looking forward to it. So I think we'll make a start and people can join us just while I'm doing the introductions. We're absolutely thrilled to welcome so many of you to this evening's lecture with Dr. Louise Fenton. And we welcome her back again. She's done lots of lectures for us as a centre, and they've all been incredibly popular and very successful. So tonight, as I said, is The Legend of Annie Palmer and Rose Hall. And we're especially delighted to welcome all our overseas attendees. We've been watching the bookings coming in, and they have been from all around the world, and particularly those people who live in Jamaica, which is where Rose Hall is located. So a very warm welcome to everybody. My name is Paula Harrison, and I am the coordinator of University Centre Telford, and I'm the host for tonight. We are part of the University of Wolverhampton, where Louise works, and we're a regional learning centre based in Telford, which is a busy town in the heart of Shropshire. And we'd normally hold this public lecture programme that we have in a range of different topics in our centre in Telford, so people could physically come and listen to Louise and other lecturers from the university. But because of the current pandemic, we have moved these lectures online, and they've been, as I said, incredibly successful and have attracted a worldwide audience. So that's been a huge benefit. So just before I introduce Louise formally and hand over to her, I just wanted to let you know that there will be an opportunity to ask questions at the end of Louise's talk. And there's a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen if you're on a laptop or a desktop. And if you are using a mobile, it will be in the top right-hand corner. So if you could use the Q&A, and I will be looking through that as we go through the talk, and then we'll pose the questions live to Louise. So just to introduce Louise to those of you who don't know her, she's a cultural historian, illustrator and writer. She has a BA and an MA in illustration from the University of Wolverhampton, and she completed her PhD on the Representations of Vodou at the University of Warwick in 2010. She's now a senior lecturer in Contextual Studies at the university, and her recent research has focused on the visual and literary representations of otherness and the social history of witchcraft, voodoo and zombies. So I'm going to hand over to Louise now and thank her very much. Thank you, Louise.
Thank you, Paula, and thank you for hosting the event again. So good evening, everybody. If you haven't attended one of these before, I just want you to know that I can't see anyone. So if you're sat with your feet up with a cup of tea, please make yourself comfortable. I don't know who's out there. I have no visuals on any of you. So as Paula said, I'm a senior lecturer at the University of Wolverhampton, and my interest in the occult, witchcraft, voodoo, Haitian vodou, stems from my PhD, which was in Caribbean history, but also over the years, I've been interested in how things have been misrepresented, because many things that I start doing my research on suddenly changes and it's not quite what it appears, as was the case with Annie Palmer and Rose Hall. So I'll tell you a little bit about Rose Hall, first of all, and what this talk is going to cover. So Rose Hall is an estate in Jamaica, previously a plantation that made rum and sugar. And Annie Palmer was a 19th century woman who found herself in charge of Rose Hall. She was reputed to have been a cruel and vicious mistress, and was even given the title the White Witch of Rose Hall, but not in her lifetime. It was also alleged, and I put that in inverted commas, she was taught Vodou in Haiti and took this knowledge with her to Jamaica. Annie Palmer has permeated popular culture, featuring in fictional literature, plays, music, and even featured in Miss Universe in 2019. Any search on the internet will throw up the malicious act and her legacy. But are these accusations either accurate or fair? No. There is some mystery surrounding Annie Palmer, but tonight I hope to give you the facts about Annie and Rose Hoare and the historical confusions and show how one story, how misrepresentations and vilification of one woman can influence the rewriting of history and persecute Annie Palmer in much the same way as women have been persecuted for witchcraft through the centuries. I called this talk, I titled it The Legend of Annie Palmer and Rose Hoare, and for the purposes of clarification, I'm using the definition of legend as a traditional story sometimes popularly regarded as historical but not authenticated, and that seems the most appropriate for this talk. So it's going to be in three parts. First of all, I'm going to tell you about Rose Hoare and a little bit about the story of Annie Palmer that you would hear if you went as a tourist. The second part, I'm going to talk about the actual history of Rose Hoare and the women who lived there. And then finally, the third part, we'll look at and examine how the stories and the horrendous acts that she's accused of evolved and how they stand today. So, Rose Hoare today. Rose Hoare Estate lies to the northwest of Jamaica, about 20 minutes drive from Montego Bay. If you look on this map, if you look towards the top left of the map, you can see two stars quite close together. One of those is Rose Hoare, so you can see where it sits within the country. Now, I know as an audience, some of you will never have heard of Rose Hoare or heard of Annie Palmer, and I'm sure some of you know the story very well. So I'm trying to cover both sides. This is a bit clearer. It shows the parishes of Hanover, St. James and Trelawney, and you can see Rose Hoare up in the top, quite near to Montego Bay. So this is Rose Hoare today. It's fully restored and open to tourists to see the former splendour of this great house. I'm going to discuss the house briefly and what can be found today and what sort of information is provided before going back to how Annie became the legend that she is. But as you can see, it's a beautiful Georgian mansion house. It has cellars, it has two levels and the basement. And it's very open so that the winds from the sea blow through. In the 1960s, this is how the house looked. It had stood empty for decades. The beautiful handcrafted interior had been stripped away by tourists. As it crumbled, people just went in and took things away. Weather has ravaged the exterior and it was in a state of disrepair. Although in this image it does look like it's been in a fire, it hasn't. This is purely decay. And from another angle, this shows you how run down it actually was, and it really was just a shell. You can see the second floor is virtually blown away. The first floor, where you can just see two people in the middle, it's empty. It is literally an empty shell, but you do see the shape of those grand staircases at the front and the steps going up. It was bought by John and Michelle Rollins in the 1970s, who restored most of the main house throughout the 70s. There were two wings to the house, and this one shows one of the wings, but they were brought down. They decided that they were going to demolish those. But the main house was brought back to its former glory, with mahogany floors, ceilings, windows, doors, wood panelling. It's got silk wallpaper. There are chandeliers dangling from the ceilings, and European antiques decorate throughout. So it's very much of its time. But you can see the footprint here. And this is where the kitchens would have been and where the slaves would have worked. But very symmetrical. It's a very symmetrical house. So you had this on both sides. Today, it sits behind the Hilton Rose Hoare Hotel. This is where many visitors come along to this part of Jamaica. This is where I actually was put up when I did my research, which was very lovely. However, what amazed me were how many people who were visiting Jamaica had no idea of the history beneath their feet or just behind the hotel. They had no idea. And Rose Hoare is actually one of the most popular of the great houses to visit. And I think a lot of that is to do with the legend of Annie Palmer. So the house actually sits just behind this hotel in where you can see all the green trees. On the estate, there's also another plantation house called Cinnamon Hill. and this is part of Rose Hall Estate. And Johnny Cash, the musician, owned and lived here for many years. And when he died, the Rollins, who own Rose Hall, they bought it back. So it's now part of the Rose Hall Estate. It is now open to visitors, but it's been left as a legacy of Johnny Cash and his wife. On the right-hand side is the part of the White Witch golf course that surrounds Rose Hall. Beautifully preserved, pristine golf course, which covers land that was once plantation. There are echoes of slavery throughout the landscape golf course and throughout the grounds. And this is another talk in itself. I could talk just on what's left and the legacy of this. But you see parts of the old machinery and these beautiful constructed buildings with such a horrific history now being reclaimed by nature. They're being wrapped around by foliage, the machinery is being dragged back into the earth, and it's quite refreshing to see that. The golf course was built around the plantation houses, and it's really odd because if you walk through the golf course, you do see just outside Cinnamon Hill, there's a tomb for one of the former overseers, and then you see these viaducts leading from Rose Hall Estate down to the sea, which is, it's really strange. And it's hard not to give opinions on this, but it's really weird that you have this legacy of slavery and what that entailed, and now they're used as backdrops to weddings. And as I said, that's a whole other discussion that we could have. This is the lead up to Rose Hall, and it's remained relatively unchanged since it was built in the 18th century. It stands in splendour to receive visitors and tourists, and the guides really do impart the history and their version of Annie Palmer. When you visit Rose Hall, you have to go on a guided tour. You can roam around the grounds on your own, but you have to be guided through the house. You're not allowed to wander aimlessly on your own. But you can see the splendour of this house, despite its history. So these are some of the restored interiors. In the top left corner, you can see one of the guides in her costume. As you can see, these mahogany floors, staircases, it shows you what the house would have been like. There are only one or two original pieces of the period. It's questionable whether they're from the original house. The owners claim they are. I've found no evidence of that, but they do say there's one or two. But it is sympathetic to the period. And it's here we're told of the fictional Annie Palmer. And this is the story that you get. That she was raised in Haiti and she was taught Vodou. She moved to Jamaica to find a wealthy husband. And this is where she married John Palmer and subsequently murdered him. She married two more and killed them both. She had a habit of taking male slaves as lovers and then murdering them when she was bored. She gave severe punishment to anyone who displeased her. And she was known to have whipped, there's a whipping post allegedly outside, which the Rollins claim they've pulled down, which is where she stood in a window and watched her slaves being whipped. She met her end when she crossed a powerful man, a slave named Taku. Annie was murdered by Taku before the slave uprising of 1831, which led to the end of Rose Hall. So you're told this, and I asked many questions because by this point, when I visited, I'd started to read other historical documents and thought some of this didn't quite add up. But these guides stick rigidly to their script. They do not deviate. If every question I asked, they just repeated part of their script. Annie is supposed to be buried in a tomb on the grounds, and this is it. Local folklore says that her tomb was meant to be sealed with a voodoo ritual that would imprison her spirit. However, the ritual was incomplete, and so three crosses are painted. You can see one white cross on the end, but there's three white crosses painted around with one side left open, and it was left open so that Annie's spirit can come and go as she pleases. And she's often said to be wandering the grounds and her horses are heard. However, when I tell you the story, you may question this. So what was the truth? To have a clear picture, I'm going to now give you an overview of the history of Rose Hall and the two women at the heart of this story. So this is the history of Rose Hall, not the fictional accounts that you'll be given on. If you look on any website, tourist information, tourist websites, visits to Rose Hall itself, the guided tours, this is now the history. This is a map from the 18th century, late 1700s, and in the centre top, this is how it would look. And it's sort of, if you look at the top, there's four sections. The second one from the left is the St James Parish. This is a bit closer. If you look at the top, you can see where it says Long Bay. And then if you look slightly to the left of that, sideways on, it says White River. Just below that, there are two squiggly vertical lines, and in between those lines, that's where Rose Hall was situated. So in 1746, Henry Fanning purchased a 290-acre plot of land to build on in preparation for his marriage. He was about to marry Rosa Kelly. They married in 1747, but Henry died just a few months later. He did actually see the purchase of the land go through, but obviously the house wasn't finished. 3 years later, in 1750, the now Rosa Fanning married George Ashe, who was a wealthy landowner who set about building a beautiful mansion for Rosa. And it's often said that Rose Hall is named after Rosa, but it's more likely it was named after the Rose family with whom George was closely associated. Sadly, in 1752, just 2 years after they got married, George died, leaving Rosa a widow once again. Now, this wasn't uncommon in the Caribbean at this time. There was yellow fever, there was yaws, there was numerous diseases, which meant that people just wouldn't survive in the 18th century. So many people's life expectancy was under 40. So George died, leaving Rosa a widow once again. And then in 1753, the next year, the now Rosa Ashe married Norwood Witter. And this appeared to be a very unhappy marriage, and Witter spent all of Rosa's money. He left her in debt, and he died in 1767. So she had 14 years with him. But it was after Witter died that she married the Honourable John Palmer in 1768. And John was custos of St James Parish. He was a widower. He had two sons who lived in England. And Rosa Palmer finally found happiness. Her and John had a happy 22-year marriage until she died in 1790, leaving Rose Hall to John in her will. As a tribute to his wife, John Palmer commissioned John Bacon to carve a memorial to her, which is in the St James Parish Church. And this is the church on the left, and on the right is the memorial he had carved. And it says, near this place are deposited the remains of Mrs. Rosa Palmer, who died on the first day of May 1790. Her manners were open, cheerful, and agreeable, and being blessed with a plentiful fortune, hospitality dwelt with her as long as health permitted her to enjoy society. Educated by the anxious care of a reverend divine, her father, her charities were not ostentatious, but a nobler kind. She was warm in her attachment to her friends and gave the most signal proof of it in the last moments of her life. This tribute of affection and respect is erected by her husband, the Honourable John Palmer, as a monument of her worth and his gratitude. So this evokes the love that he felt for her. And this on the left is the actual monument. You can see the inscription underneath it, but it's a beautifully carved memorial to her. And then on the right of this picture is the actual grave of Rosa Palmer. And this says, underneath this stone are deposited the remains of Rosa Palmer, wife of the Honourable John Palmer of this parish, who died the 1st of May 1790, aged 72 years. So there's no scandal. She wasn't murdered. Her previous three husbands died of natural deaths, which was not uncommon in Jamaica of this time. And so you start to question, well, if it wasn't her, who was it? John did marry again after Rosa's death. He married Rebecca Ann James. And when he died, he left her an annuity. She returned to the UK and she married again. She married Nathaniel Weeks and lived out her days in Sidmouth, where she died in 1846. So she never had the property, but she did have an annuity from the property. John Palmer died in 1797 and he left the property to his two sons, John and James. They never visited Jamaica as far as records show, and both of them died childless. So in 1818, the estates of Rosehall and Palmyra, which was another plantation that he owned, were passed to the Honourable John Palmer's grandnephew, John Rose Palmer. So this is a map from 1804, which shows Rosehall. If you see the number 13 at the top, slightly to the left of that, it says Little River. And if you go diagonally slightly to the left, you can see Rosehall. And then if you go down diagonally slightly to the right, you can see Cinnamon Hill, which is what I mentioned, where Johnny Cash lived and which is now owned and part of the Rosehall estate. And then if you go to the bottom, sort of directly below the number 13 at the bottom, that's where Palmyra was. And you can see that's a little bit inland. This is a drawing by James Hakewell from 1820-21. He did tour of the West Indies and did a lot of drawings. But this is Rosehall. And as you can see from the earlier picture I showed you, this is the lead up, the road that leads up to the house. And John Rose Palmer met Annie Mary Patterson they fell in love, and she was from Jamaica. She'd lived in Jamaica. And they got married on the 28th of March in St. James, Jamaica. Annie was only 17 at the time, but again, this was not uncommon. They also went on honeymoon and married again on the 16th of September, 1821 in Dorset, UK. At the time, it was not always deemed that a marriage in Jamaica was proper and official. So it was quite common for the British to come back to the UK to get married again. And so this is the history. You've just heard about Rosa Palmer. She did have four husbands. She outlived the fourth. The previous three just died. Rebecca Ann Palmer was very short in the history of Rosehall, had a great annuity from it, but she went back to the UK. And now we're on to the story of Annie Mary Palmer. And this is where all the stories seem to merge. In the accounts that I've read, Annie had no parents. She wasn't raised in Haiti, and the current Annie Palmer did lose her father early, because in the stories it says that she had no parents and no one to look after her, which is why her governess took her to Haiti, and that wasn't the case. She lost her father just before she was born, but she was brought up by her mother Juliana, her grandfather, the Honourable William Brown, her stepfather, Captain David Boyd. She wasn't abandoned, and she was brought up on a property that was usual for the time and of her class. So she was married to John Rose Palmer, and he died at Rosehall just 7 years later in 1827. He wasn't murdered, there was no suspicion, there was no scandal in any of the papers. His obituary in the Kingston Chronicle describes him: his intrinsic work, kind heart and generous disposition obtained him the esteem of all his acquaintances, but to his family and those friends who had the pleasure of being intimate with him, his loss is irreparable. No evidence, no murder, no motive. When John died, he did leave Annie in debt, and she had no money at all. So she had to sell her rights to Rosehall and Palmyra, which she did to Dr. Bernard in Bristol in 1830. Annie's uncle by marriage, William Augustus Dixon, it appears he bought up the estates from Dr. Bernard and subsequently put Annie in charge of them. So she was left in charge of some of the estate because on the records in the almanacs, the returns of slaves shows that she has four slaves. It's marked as eight, but that's because she didn't do a return 1 year, so it was doubled. But she had four slaves with her, which was a family. It was a husband, wife, and two children. And she moved to Bellevue. He then allowed her to live there after his death. And here you can see a quote from his will: "My settlement in St. James, called Bellevue, I leave to Mrs. Palmer for her life. After her death, the said property to be sold and the money to be appropriated as hereinafter mentioned." So he looked after her. Annie Mary Palmer never married again, and she had no children. She died in 1846 in relative obscurity, aged just 44 years old. She was buried at St James Church, but there's no gravestone remaining. In her will, she left all her possessions to her goddaughter, Geolia Mary Spence, who at the time was just 2 years old. So those are the stories of the women who lived at Rose Hall. As you can see, it was pretty much of the time. There is a whole other conversation to have around the fact that they were white, powerful, in charge, and they were involved in slavery. And that is another discussion altogether. But I still want to focus on the fact this is about Annie Mary Palmer. So how did Annie Palmer of Rose Hall become the white witch and the voodoo queen that she's known of today? And this part is about the vilification of Annie Palmer. There's a book that's published in 1928, which I'm going to mention in a moment, but rumours and allegations actually began nearly a century before the book was published. Reverend Hope Masterton Waddell was a Scottish missionary, and he went out to the West Indies and Jamaica and Central Africa, but in his memoirs, he did visit Rose Hall and Palmyra in 1830. In some accounts I've read from archivists of the 1960s, they mention a pamphlet that he wrote that mentions a Mrs. Palmer at Palmyra was strangled. I haven't found that document, so if anybody has seen it or knows where it is, that would be fantastic. I've only got hearsay on that. But in his books and in his memoirs, he does talk about preaching at Rose Hall and Palmyra, and in his writings he mentions a spiked collar that was used on slaves, implying the cruelty that was involved in slavery. He was an abolitionist. However, there's a hypocrisy with his writings because he often talks about the slaves living in sin, and when they've had children born of their white masters, they're the ones who are persecuted and they should be pushed aside. They can't, they're sinful, and he cannot bring them into his flock. And again, another legacy of slavery. But this story of Rosa Palmer or Mrs. Palmer being strangled at Palmyra is very difficult because Rosa Palmer wasn't strangled. She died aged 72, as is all very clear, and Annie Palmer was still alive in 1830. So he may have been told a story about a murder which he misunderstood and misquoted and then wrote in his memoirs. So this is his book, 29 Years in the West Indies and Central Africa, which does mention his preaching at Rose Hall and Palmyra. Annie Palmer has been a subject of debate in the Daily Gleaner or the Sunday Gleaner since 1895. There was a pamphlet written by James Costello, which was published in 1868 in the Falmouth Post. And this had a letter from a Mr. Broderick, who claims to have worked as an overseer to Mrs. Palmer, and a letter from Richard Hill giving a testimony from his parents. So these newspaper articles, there are a number of them. I'm just going to read a little bit out, just very briefly, because it's this authentication. And on the 13th of May, there's a letter that says Mrs. Palmer was reputed to have killed her three husbands, and it was rumoured that the fourth Mr. Palmer, having cause to fear a similar fate, incited the female slaves to kill her, which they did, in the manner described by Mr. Broderick, which refers back to the 1868 article. I distinctly remember being told of circumstance that she dropped molten grease on the floor to detect whether these domestics had failed to polish same, and on finding her ruse successful, attempted to horsewhip them, which resulted in her murder. I do not remember ever hearing of any other Mrs. Palmer in respect of these traditions, and in view of the foregoing, I certainly think Mr. Broderick's information is authentic. So here he is in the Daily Gleaner, saying that the 1868 article is authentic, which gives this rise to Mrs. Palmer being murdered and being very cruel. Slightly later, on May 15th, 18, so a couple of days later, there's a very long piece, a very long letter, but the gist of it is that he talks about the two Mrs. Palmers. So he gives reference to the fact that there was Rosa and Annie, and that the first Mrs. Palmer was the good Mrs. Palmer, but Annie was the bad Mrs. Palmer. So you get this repetition of fiction in newspaper accounts. And these go back, so this is from 1830 to 1895, the story, The Little Seeds Being Planted. In 1911, Joseph Shaw then includes two chapters in his book, giving the difference between the good Mrs. Palmer and the bad Mrs. Palmer, which is harking back to the letters in the Gleaner. And there's a chapter called The Mystery of Rose Hall, followed by a chapter called The True Tale of Rose Hall, giving this oral testimony. And he refers to the fact that he heard testimony from actual slaves. So he plagiarises his sources from the Gleaner, whose letters then plagiarise sources from the 1868 Falmouth Post. And you can see how this consecutive storytelling evolves. In 1928, all these strands of misinformation and misrepresentation are brought together and consolidated in The White Witch of Rose Hall by Herbert G. DeLisa. And this is when Annie Palmer got her title. It brings together the lives of Rosa and her four husbands, and Annie, whose quiet life never did anything, no evidence that she ever did anything wrong, but it adds to it the letters of the 19th century, and the legend was made. And it's this story that is referred back to in nearly every bit of misinformation I could find on websites, tour guides, pamphlets, brochures. It's this one that seems to carry the story. In 1956, the story was retold by Harold Underhill in Jamaica White. He uses the name from the 1868 letter, and he calls one of the overseers Broderick. Follows a very similar narrative to DeLisa, so very little has changed. And just inside the cover, it says that Underhill spent 2 years researching Rose Hall and Annie Palmer, but I've got to say, I don't think he did a very good job. Johnny Cash recorded The Ballad of Annie Palmer in 1973. So this was a time when Rose Hall was being refurbished, the tale was circulating, the legend was quite, people knew of the legend at this point. And I want you to listen to the lyrics. This is only two and a half minutes long, so I'm going to play this, but please listen to the lyrics and the story that Johnny Cash tells.
One time I went down to Jamaica to a place called Rose Hall Plantation. They grow a lot of sugar cane and tomatoes and things at Rose Hall now. It used to be just a sugar cane plantation back in the days of slavery. And they tell stories about the place and about the great house at Rose Hall that many, many years ago, there came from the country of Haiti a lady named Annie Palmer who lived in that great house there. And she was the mistress of the plantation. She was the boss. Her word was law. Well, they tell a lot of tales about Annie. They say she had three husbands, one at a time, I guess. But they also tell tales about Annie and the slaves. There were about 5,000 slaves on the plantation. She had her favorites, and she had the ones that weren't her favorites. Well, down on the sea, there are three tall palm trees waving in the breeze, and they say that maybe Annie Palmer's three husbands are buried under those palm trees. On the island of Jamaica, quite a long, long time ago, at Rose Hall Plantation, where the ocean breezes blow, lived a girl named Annie Palmer, the mistress of the place. And the slaves all lived in fear to see a frown on Annie's face. Where's your husband, Annie? Where's number two and three? Are they sleeping neath the palms beside the Caribbean Sea? At night I hear you ride, and I hear your lover's call, and I still can feel your presence round the great house at Rose Hall. Well, if you should ever go to see the great house at Rose Hall, there's expensive chairs and china and great paintings on the wall. They'll show you Annie's sitting room and the whipping post outside. But They won't let you see the room where Annie's husband's died. Where's your husband, Annie? Where's number two and three? Are they sleeping neath the palms beside the Caribbean Sea? At night I hear you writing, and I hear your lover's call, and I still can feel your presence round the great house at Rose Hall.
So thanks to Johnny Cash, who at that time, he would have just moved into Cinnamon Hill, which was next door. The restoration of Rose Hall was happening, so his Ballad of Annie Palmer would have regurgitated Delisa's novel and obviously would have been a draw for tourists. He mentions the thousands of slaves, but records show that at the very peak, there were no more than about 600. He talks about the three palm trees, which I will show you in a moment. But again, shortly after, so we've already had all the newspaper articles planting that seed. We've got Delisa's novel, we've got Johnny Cash, we've got another novel in 56. And then in 2005, Mike Henry published Rose Hall's White Witch, The Legend of Annie Palmer, which includes at the start a brief historical foreword, which includes reference to the 1831 death of Annie, which we know wasn't the case. She died in 1846. 1831 is the date in Delisa's novel, and also that Rose Hall burnt to the ground, which it never did. There are some accounts that Palmyra burned down, as did many of the plantation houses during the slave revolt of 1831-32, but not of that one. Ghost hunting has become very popular in the 21st century, and in 2010, the Ghost Hunters International recorded an episode at Rose Hall looking for the ghost of Annie Palmer. And then Ghost Adventures in 2013, who investigated both Cinnamon Hill and Rose Hall. And Michelle Rollins was actually interviewed in the Ghost Adventures episode, which you can see online. But again, she's perpetuating the myth of Annie Palmer. And I understand why, because it's a big tourist draw and it's a sensational story, but it's not true. These are the three palm trees that they mention in the song that you'll hear mentioned in the Ghost Adventures, Ghost Stories. And this is where Annie Palmer is alleged to have buried her three husbands, even though we know that's not true. More recently, a little bit more controversy in Miss Universe in 2019, there was huge social media outpouring when Miss Jamaica wore this gown, which was the Annie Palmer White Witch of Rose Hall gown. And it was interesting. I had a quick trawl through the social media at the time and the responses. And the Jamaica Travel and Culture explains who Annie was, that she was an accomplished practitioner of Haitian Vodou, and during her reign at Rose Hall, murdered her husbands and countless slave lovers. Her reign of terror was ended when she was murdered, and so on and so on. And in response, which I find even more fascinating, was that we never sought to glorify slavery nor promote witchcraft or any of the folk tales Annie Palmer has been accused of. Instead, we sought to do, as have the pantomimes, books and articles written about her, just tell the story of part of Jamaican history without endorsing, glorifying or celebrating her deeds or the atrocities of slavery. The conversations resulting could lead to teachable moments for the young people who have no interest in history taught in a traditional way. The organisation continued by saying, obviously, we've succeeded in this mission as people are now talking about this aspect of Jamaican history, even though it's not the history, and we hope they will be motivated to engage in further research to have a greater understanding of our past. And it's only that sentence that I can agree with. Yes, please, please look at it properly. Sorry, I'm ranting now. Okay, so uncovering the truth. There have been attempts to redress the balance. There are articles from the 1960s, Frederick de Quesnay in 64, Geoffrey Yates in 65, and Glory Robertson in 68. This is Geoffrey Yates's article he published in the Sunday Gleaner in 1965. Part one was The True Tale of the White Witch of Rose Hall, Death of a Legend, followed by the Rose Hall legend, Was It Really Annie? And if you don't manage to find these through the newspaper archives, they are on the Jamaican Archives website, so you can read the full article. But he puts across the story. He puts across how her name was in the papers before she'd even died. She's supposed to have died 17 years before she actually did. And he does try to redress the balance. This article by Gloria Robertson was from December 1968 in the Jamaica Journal. And again, you can get this online. It's called The Rose Hall Legend. And that painting I showed you earlier, she tells the true story behind the Mrs. Palmers of Rose Hall. In 2011, the first international reggae wine festival in Montego Bay, they offered tours, and on the information brochures they put out, they offered a tour of Rose Hall and put at the bottom, an investigation of the case in 2007 by Benjamin Radford showed the case to have been based on a fictional story, which is great. There are academic contributions. Laura Lomas wrote an article on Mystifying Mystery, Inscriptions of the Oral Legend of Rose Hall. In 2014, Jennifer Donahue talked about the ghost of Annie Palmer and gave voice to the White Witch of Rose Hall. And then most recently, in the Journal of Global Slavery, Natalie Zajcek did an article on the female slaveholder, which was about Annie Palmer and also Madame Lalaurie in New Orleans. So there have been these contributions to trying to redress the balance, but they're not widely known about and they're not widely disseminated. And it's often said to me, why let truth stand in the way of a good story? And it is a good story, and it does bring in tourism, and people are fascinated by the fictional Annie Palmer. But she's been vilified now for over a century, and I think it's time for this to change. So to summarise, Rosa Palmer did have four husbands. Three of them died of natural causes. Annie Palmer was of Scottish heritage, born and brought up on Jamaica, not Haiti. There were never thousands of slaves at Rose Hall. It was a slave plantation. At most, there were several hundred. Annie Palmer married just once and was not murdered in 1831 at any time. She died in 1846. The stories of the two Mrs. Palmers have been merged, and they've been misrepresented for nearly two centuries. So I think it's now time to set the story straight. Thank you for listening.
That was brilliant, Louise. Thank you very much. Fascinating lecture. And your next lecture is on Tuesday, the 16th of March, on pitchfork murders.
Pitchfork murders. I'm looking at witchcraft accusations in rural Warwickshire. And these are two accounts of murders that took place in the late 19th century and early 20th century, both cases involving pitchforks and both involving accusations of witchcraft.
Fantastic. And Dave is already looking forward to it, he says, so that's brilliant. So thank you ever so much once again, Louise. That was fascinating. And thank you for your time and all your research. And thank you, everybody, for attending and for all the comments. And hope you have a good rest of the evening. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.